In February 1953, we were confronted with a very hard storm surge. The strong winds pushed the water inside the southern part of the North Sea and raised the water level here in the Oosterschelde. The water level went up. In the Netherlands, heavy storms always come from the northwest. At this location, it means it came from that direction. That means there were no waves at this area. Normally, there were no big waves during storms at the dikes here. So therefore, the dikes were designed in such a way that they could cope with high water levels, but not with high waves. In 1953, the water level was much higher than the designed water level. So therefore, the dike was overtopped and a breach occurred. You see behind me still the area where the dike was breached. Because it became very deep over there, it was not possible to close the dike at that location and a new circular dike was built. At this location, we are at this moment at the location where this dike was closed. At that place, a caisson was put into the water.
Schelphoek is located along the Oosterschelde estuary in the southwest of the Netherlands. In 1953, this location was open to the sea. The main wind direction for storm winds is from the northwest, so there is usually not a lot of wave action on this dike. This explains why there is usually not much wave action in front of the dike. This picture shows the situation at this moment. The location of the breach is at location A. You can still see the remainders of the old dike. For the closure, a new semicircular dike has been made. The final closure was done with a caisson. This is visible at location C. The artificial island B has nothing to do with this closure. It has recently been constructed to increase the ecological value of the area.
In the semicircular dike, there was one remaining gap we closed. For this closure, they used a caisson which was left over from the Allied landings in Normandy. This was a box caisson which was intended to be used as a harbor caisson, a breakwater caisson, so it has no sluice function. So therefore it has to be placed in one operation and directly close the whole thing. That worked in this case because they had a lot of preparation and a lot of bed protections. Behind me you see the remains of this caisson. You see only the top because it's some 10 meters high. The rest is inside the dike at this moment. In the time when this was still open, so that was a couple of months, there was quite a lot of current in this area. This current scoured out a number of channels. And the remainders of these channels you can still see at the other area over there, where there is still a water area which is in effect the remainder of this tidal gully which occurred during the few months when it was open.
In the right picture, you see the final closing caisson embedded in the new dike. The caisson used for this closing was a leftover caisson from the Allied landings at Arromanches, Normandy in 1944. These caissons were constructed in the UK and towed over to France to create a temporary harbour. In 1953, we could buy a few leftover caissons for closing the breaches in our dikes. Because these caissons were originally intended as breakwater elements, they are closed boxes and no sluice caissons. On this very important difference we will come back later in this course. A comparison of the present situation with the pre-1953 situation. Both pictures are on the same scale. On the 1950 map you see a small gap in the main dike. Behind that gap was the tiny harbor of Schelphoek, surrounded by relatively low dikes. These dikes overtopped in 1953 and failed. This slide shows the situation 1 week after breaching. You can clearly see the location of the breach. It has a width of some 200 meters and is not very deep. Behind the breach, some erosion already took place. Realize that the part north of the broken dike was completely inundated. The height of this land is approximately 1.2 meters below mean sea level. Normal low water is here approximately 1.5 meter below mean sea level. This means that during most of the time all the land was covered with water with a depth of between nearly 0 and 3 meters, depending on the tide. And an enormous mass of water was flowing in and out the breach every tide. Because of this strong flow, already after 3 weeks, the size of the gap has increased significantly, but also the depth has increased a lot. On the 8th of April, the depth in the breach was already 20 meters, and the gap width has increased to 300 meters. In the next 3 weeks, the maximum depth remained more or less the same, but the deep part increased in size. Also, quite some land was eroded and tidal creeks were formed. This breach was only one of the 70 large breaches which occurred during the storm, and it was also one of the largest. Therefore, it took some time before detailed plans could be made for the closure. In May, the creeks had enlarged again, and it was clear that closing a gap along the original trajectory was completely impossible. It was already too deep and the flow velocities were too high. Therefore, it was decided to make a new dike, approximately 1 kilometer more inland. The first task is then always to prevent that this selected trajectory for the closure will erode more. So one has to start with placing a bed protection along this line. In May, already a smart part was protected, indicated with the word bezinking. This bed protection consists of fascine mattresses with a thin layer of heavy stones. 1 month later, the western bed protection was already completed and a small part of the new closure dam on the west side was also ready. In the middle, a small island has been constructed to act as a working base for the final closure. In August, the bed protection was completed and also the middle dam section was ready. End of August, the western part of the closure dam on the shallow part and the bed protections were completed. In this section, the dam was made using prefabricated small concrete caissons. In this picture, the flow over the sill can be seen. A part of the concrete caisson dam has been constructed. The floating crane is placing the concrete boxes on top of each other. This picture gives a good view of the flow pattern in the area. Because the flow area over the sill is long, the velocities on the sill are relatively low, and also turbulence is limited. This prevents extra scour. In this picture, the sea is on the left and the inundated land is on the right. This picture gives an overview of the whole area. Note that apart from the new dike, one sees only water in this picture. But most of the water is shallow, so one cannot easily sail with large vessels in this area. The final gap was closed with a large caisson. This was the Phoenix caisson from the Allied landings. It is a closed box and has therefore to be placed in one operation during slack water, neap tide. After completion of the closure of the gap by placing the caisson, a new dike was built at the location of the closing gap. The caisson is filled largely with sand after placing. Because of that, the caisson is nearly completely buried in the soil. And at this moment, only the top of the caissons can be seen. The caisson was originally accessible by holes in the top. For safety reasons, these holes are now completely covered by concrete plates.